yesterday. It's over. Now either I'm gonna trust, or I may as well walk away. 'Cause stressing don't make it better. Don't make it better, no way.
Yesterday.
Oh, yesterday.
Yesterday. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yesterday, amen. She said at the end of that song, I decided to leave my tears in yesterday. I decided to leave my tears in yesterday. In yesterday. Yesterday's gone. Amen. Tomorrow's not promised. But this is the day that the Lord has made. I shall rejoice, and I'm going to be glad in it. I thank God that he allowed me, he allowed you, my brothers and sisters, to rise up this morning. Amen. And I ask you right now, if you can, in whatever way you find fit, to give God praise, to give him honor. You could do it by the clap of your hands. This could be by amen. It could be a thank you, Father. Let us not take this day for granted. I left those tears, Jesus. And that jumped out at me as many times I heard that song. And I love that song. I love Mary, Mary. I love their life. Amen. They are amazing. Amen. I left those tears in yesterday. Yesterday. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Yes, the pain was real. The disappointment was real. I cried those tears. Amen. I thank God. Amen. Weeping may endure for a night or so. And sometimes those nights seem like they're forever. But joy is coming in the morning. Good morning, manna, to each and every one of you as you greet each other. And I see some of you have already greeted each other. Amen. Thank you, Father. That's right, Sister Tashima. Thank you, Father. Yes. Yes, that pain of yesterday. Amen. But I'm pressing toward the mark of the Most High. Amen. And the other part of the song is very powerful. And it comes from really Jeremiah 32 and 27. 32 and 27. You know, because he had to encourage Jeremiah. Because Jeremiah was going through some very challenging and very difficult things. And I'm sharing this with you as well as we get into our lesson. Amen. He had called the prophet Jeremiah. And if we had more Jeremiahs or Jeremiah type leaders and pastors and believers. Amen. Jeremiah was called to preach to a nation. He was a prophet. And I think later on, we're going to get to prophecy and what we think prophecy is. But most times when prophets came around, people were not glad to see them. Prophets were not ones that brought you always good news. It was good news, but it was wrapped in some information that told you you needed to get yourself together. And we know how it is. People don't want to hear, get yourself together. And it's not a punishment. It's not a coming down on someone. But for what God has for you, even when it comes to the word of God, sometimes, amen, it's hard to receive what the word says because it challenges. It challenges where we are. It does not mean you in a terrible state. It means that I am not in a place where God desires for me to be. Amen. I know what yesterday, oh, come on. I know what yesterday did to you. I know what yesterday did to you. Amen. But you got to trust God in your today. In your today. Give him praise for today. Give him praise for today. See, you can give him praise. I always say give him praises for what God is about to come. Amen. Because there are some things, even in your yesterday, and it's so powerful in this song, because I thought about even on this week about, you know, most of the time we talk about our past and we don't want a lot of things of the past to come with us into our future. But what we do want to come with us is the lessons we learned from our past. The testimony, because your testimony is a testimony from your past. Isn't that something how God does that? Something as painful and as more disappointing as our past could have been, whether because of decisions we made or other people made for our lives and decided to impose their things on us. Amen. And I think about, you know, getting dropped. Sometimes we got dropped along the way. The people that we should have trusted, people that we should have believed in. Amen. Whether they were in our families or whether it was in the church, wherever they made, they were folks, they were people. Amen. But in spite of it all, look at you. Amen. I know we say it as cliches, but it's so true. I don't look like what I've been through. And some of us don't look like what we're going through. Some of us don't look like we're going through a pandemic. Some of us don't live like we're going through a pandemic. But my God, amen. God is wonderful. And Jeremiah was challenged. He was challenged. He preached for, I believe, I want to say 25 years. Amen. And people didn't listen. They didn't listen. He got to the point where he got mad. He got in the street. And I don't know if you know the story, but he was in the street, rolling in the street with no clothes on. He was so disappointed, so much hurt. And what God told Jeremiah, and I'm telling this to you, they're not rejecting you, but they're rejecting me. And many people are not rejecting you. They're rejecting the God that's in you. I've been telling you about this saga of this young man that I've been dealing with. And you know that God has his attention because he keeps making his way back to me. Argumentative, defiant, and sometimes getting a little worse and worse. But I put a proclamation over his life yesterday, and I don't do that. I put a proclamation over his life. And I'm going to tell you something. When you speak what the Holy Spirit tells you, whatever's operating in someone or something that is not in line with God, because it's the word of God, I saw the person go from 90 to 5. He came here and he said, "What do you mean?" I had his undivided attention because I said, "What thus says the Lord." And I'm quite sure that Jeremiah did the same thing. But what he said in Jeremiah 32 and 27, in tying with the song that was just saying about yesterday, he says, "I am the Lord, the God of all mankind. Is anything too hard for me?" And that's my question to you today. Is there anything that's too hard for my God? Whatever you're experiencing, whatever you're going through right now, Mother Johnson, I know you're going through, but God is able to send you peace. He's able to comfort you. Yes, let your tears roll. That is our natural humanistic side. We're supposed to mourn. We're supposed to grieve. Amen. Because whenever we lose something or someone, amen, it's a part of us, especially if they were near and dear to our heart. That's what makes life so precious, Bishop. If life is precious and we cannot take anything for granted. Yes, we may be a certain age, amen, and we've seen these many years, amen, but we have to honestly, you know, take each day, one day at a time and love God, amen, because there is nothing too hard for God. He's a miracle-working God. He's a God of peace. He's a God of joy, no matter what you're facing, no matter what you're dealing with. And again, with this young man, as soon as I said that, he started talking about a situation. All of a sudden, it was about the reality of what was really going on. And God will allow you to see what's really going on. The whole time, it was this, defending and fighting. Then all of a sudden, his heart opened up. And healing will begin. I'm telling you what God will do. Amen. I'm telling you what God will do if you trust him, if you believe him. Amen. As we've been talking about the gifts of the Spirit that we were talking about on last week, we finished off in faith, the gift of faith, not just saving faith, the faith that got you saved, the faith that got you into the door. Amen. Amen. As you can see the shirt that I have on, I don't know if you can see the whole thing. We snap a little bit. Amen. His grace, his glory is his grace. Amen. We believe the faith that we have brings us into grace. The faith that we have in God brings us to its unmerited favor. Amen. That allows us, amen, even from our yesterday, I might have failed yesterday. I may have came short yesterday. But even in that, even in my flesh, even in my weakness, Sister Bev, even in all that, God's grace is taking me through. Grace is not just about obtaining things and getting things from God. Amen. It's the doors that he opens, the ways that he makes. Amen. He makes a way, because a lot of us, I know for myself, and even when his brother was talking yesterday, he was talking about his past and there was other people in the room. I said, you look around this room, none of us If without the grace of God, we'll be here right now. None of us right now that's on this broadcast will be here if it had not been for the grace of God. Think about, and I'm not talking about the devil. I'm not talking about the devil. I'm talking about some decisions that we made, you know, yesterday. Some decisions that we made were not the best decision. Amen. The reason why we were not consumed, the reason why we were not overtaken. Amen. Because of his grace. And you know what's on the other side of his grace? It's his glory. It's his glory. It's his grace, his glory. You did not make this on your own. You didn't come this far by your own. That's why each and every day when you get up, you thank God, amen, that you have feelings in your extremities, that you could see, you could smell, you could do those things. Think about it. During this COVID, amen, people told me they lost their sense of smell. They lost their sense of taste, amen. Those basic things, Pastor Joshua, the basic things we lost. I remember a friend of mine was going through a bout with cancer, and she said she could not bend over. If she bent over, she would get dizzy and pass out. And she was going through this for so long. And then she said one day she was in the bathroom and her toothbrush fell on the floor. And, you know, it's your toothbrush. So she immediately bent down and she realized, oh, my God, I was able to bend down. The things we take for granted, the people we take for granted, amen, the God we take for granted. God don't owe us anything. Grace, unmerited, unmerited, undeserved. We have not done anything to earn it. As a matter of fact, he gave that we may receive. He gave a free gift. He gave the gift of the Holy Spirit. He gave salvation. Amen. He gave this freely to us. Why? Because he loved us. And that's the love that he wants us to embrace. He wants us to recognize the love he has for us. And when you recognize God's unmerited favor, because that's what agape love is. Agape love. Amen. Is unmerited love. Is undeserved love. Is unconditional. Unconditional. Here's the thing, my brothers and sisters. Amen. God don't love your sin. He don't love our sin. Not because our sin is an indication of our person. Amen. But our sin would mess up our destiny. He loves you unconditionally. But he don't love our sin because he know the damage that your sin is doing against. And what happens is because the battle of our flesh that loves sin, that loves a sin, that sinful nature is always fighting against your spiritual man. Amen. Always fighting. So it's always trying to pull you. That's why the Bible says, I will let nothing, anything, talk about these heights, these perils, and all these other things, separate me from the love of God. Not the love for God, but the love of God. See, that's the love for God comes as a result of the love of God. See, the love of God, the way God, Brother John, the way God loves us, it's the love we look for in everybody else that do not have the capacity, not to the degree which God does it. But what he expects from us, what he gives to us, he wants us to give to others. Again, we talk about stewardship this week on this month. What he gives to us, he wants us to manage and distribute it to other people. Amen. Yes, we could give out clothes. We could give out food. And I'm going to tell you this. Anybody could give out clothes. Anybody could give out food. Anybody could give out water. That's very honorable. But when you do it in the love of God, I'm not giving you this to receive anything in return. I'm not doing this so that people could see me doing it. I'm doing this out of the love of God, the overflow. Overflow. If I want to, we're talking about overflow, more than enough, not enough room to receive it. How about the love of God? Overflow, more than enough, not enough room to receive it. Amen. Let my cup runneth over. Our cup runneth over can't always be about our money. It can't be about our materialistic thing. But how about an overflow of the love of God? That's what's wrong with the world. I know it's an old song, and I don't even know what their intentions was when Burt Bacharach wrote this song and Dionne Warwick sang it. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Amen. But what they really need, and I don't know if they were talking about love or they were talking about lust. But what the world needs now is the agape love. And the reason that I would say the world is in this condition is because the church, oh no, not your building, the church, you and I are not showing forth that love for one another. We're not showing that love for one another, not to one another, but for one another. See, two is like, I'm gonna demonstrate it, but when I have that love for you, when I have that love for you, that means I'm concerned about you. Even if I get nothing around, I'm concerned about your soul. Again, even with husbands and wives, amen. Husbands and wives, amen. You in a relationship. Yes, that is that love for one another. That's that eros love, amen. That passionate, erotic love you have for one another. But you don't got to supersede that. Agape love. Sister Norma, agape love got to override that. And that's why we mess up sometimes. Because when it's always about eros, because eros is really about exchange. But when it's agape love, here, I got enough love for you. You know, and my cup running over. There's a source. I got enough love to pour into you. I can love you even when you hate me. That's why sometimes it's difficult for the world to understand us when we're forgiving. A lot of people will look at us that we're weak and we're this. But the power, when we honor God, because again, when I do this, it's his glory. God gets the glory out of this. It may make me even look bad. They were like, don't you know that brother? Don't you know that sister was talking about you? Don't you know that brother, that sister walked out on you? Don't you know that brother, that sister, that individual did you wrong? Yes, I do. I don't like it. Now, I'm not telling you to be foolish, but what happens is you need to examine that too. Why does that keep happening? Why do we keep putting ourselves in that position? Let me tell you something. Guard your grace. That's something God gave me during this pandemic. Pastors, God gave me that. He said, God, guard your grace. God has given us a certain grace on our life that's not to be given to any and everybody, because everybody don't understand this grace that God has put on your life. Many of you right now have a grace on your life to do certain things. Do not handle it weakly. Do not handle it, without being careful with it, because we give it out to people what God has given to us, amen. And this grace, amen, I earned this grace, not earned, but this grace I obtained through some series of events in my life, and God has allowed, not just me, but I'm talking about you as well. But because of this grace, what you're looking at right now is God's glory. This is what the glory of God looks like. This is what the glory, that's what I said about that. This is what the glory of God looks like. This is what the glory of God, because of his grace. And I describe grace as a person or an individual, just in a metaphoric way, about that comes as wait for you outside. Grace is waiting for you outside. Grace is your ride, amen. Stop getting in with any and everything else, amen. Grace is your ride and mercy is going to follow you. Amen. Mercy will follow you. I tell you, mercy will follow you. Amen. Grace is going to take you there. Grace is going to get you there. But there's a car behind you called mercy. The reason why the car behind you is called mercy, in case I mess up, in case I fall back, in case I dismiss the grace and don't honor the grace that God has put in my life. Amen. Mercy. Mercy is for the things that I should get, but God doesn't allow it to come on me. Mercy is the things that I should get. And I'm talking about not the good stuff. It's the stuff that I deserve, but God said, mercy, have mercy on their soul. Have mercy on their soul. And grace is the things that I get that I don't even deserve. Get that? Mercies are the things that didn't happen, that should have happened. Grace is the things that God gives to you, because grace is birthed out of love. The agape love of God bursts out grace. The reason there's grace, and can I go a little bit deeper with that too? We're talking about be ye holy, for I am holy. And sometimes what we do, we make holiness the pinnacle, the top part of which we're trying to strive for. And we should live a life that's separated. Amen. But what you should be striving for is the love of God. The love of God. Because here's the love of God, his holiness. On my way to the love of God, I'm going to catch holiness. I'm going to meet holiness on the fourth floor. And when I get to the fifth floor, grace is waiting for me right there. On my way up. But what happens is we're trying to get to holiness and never get to grace. We never get the grace. We get to this floor. I'm on the fourth floor and we stop at the fourth floor. Oh, I'm holy, but you ain't got the love of God in you. You ain't got the love. Yeah, you separate. I know. Yeah, that's why you could be mean and saved. That's why people could be mean. There's no way you're going to be holy and don't have the love of God. You got to complete the task. Amen. You got to complete the task. Amen. That was not what I was talking about this morning. Amen. Mother Johnson, it got to be love. It got to be love, the love of God in our hearts. It got to be flowing out of our heart. It got to be the culture that we're in. Amen. What happens is when we get off track, when we get off course, when we lose focus of why we're in church, why you serve. I serve because God's been good to me. I serve because of his grace. God, the opportunity. Now, I use that word opportunity. And when I use the word opportunity, it's in exchange for the word grace. When God gives me the opportunity to stand before you or sit before you on a morning like this to share with you in his word, that's because of the grace of God, amen, that has allowed me to see another day, that's given me strength, that gave me the capacity of my mind, that gave me the articulation of speech, amen, to be comprehensive in what I say, amen, to pull it together, because it's just not ordinary stuff. This is the grace of God, Mother Tisdale. This is the grace of God, amen. And out of this, you and I become the glory. We become the light that shine forth that men will see, amen, that they will see in this earth realm. Amen. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. We got to light this place up. We got to give some flavor to this. Amen. So as we're talking about this, and we're talking about, we have finished, was closing out on the gift of faith. And like I said, it's not just saving faith. It's not the faith where I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart. Now I'm saved. I'm rescued. I'm in the boat. Amen. I'm in the boat, but you got to be careful. Don't bring the water in the boat. Don't bring the water in the boat. Don't, in other words, don't bring the world into the boat. God has put you in a safe place, and that's what happens many times. God puts you in a place. You get out the boat. You're like, I can't wait. It's taking too long to get here, and it seems like this boat is just in a holding pattern. And what we do, we get anxious. Amen. We get anxious. Amen. And we jump out the boat, and we say, well, I could see the shoreline right there. I could see the next stop right there. And we get impatient. And God, and whatever God's doing in your life, I'm speaking to somebody's heart right now. You don't get impatient. You're about to move too quickly. Amen. Wait on the Lord. Amen. There's strength in waiting on the Lord. Don't get out the boat. He's like, you know what? I don't see no sharks in the water. It looks safe. The waters look calm. Amen. That's why when the Bible talks about in Psalms 23, this about the shepherd, he make me to lie down in green pasture, right? He make me. Why do you have to make me? Because you don't know how to feed yourself. You're not to feed yourself, but you're over there eating poison ivy. You're over there eating stuff that you should not eat. That's why he gives you a shepherd, a leader who makes you lie down. This is part of your transformation. Amen. And this is what we fight against sometimes. You like sweets. Amen. You like sweets. You don't like vegetables. You don't like the things that's good for you. Amen. But you want these things. So the shepherd have to. Then what he does, he leads me by the water. He leads me to the quiet stream. And why he leads me to the quiet stream? Because sheep are very timid. Very, very frightful animals. And what happens is, Sister Iranda, he'll lead him by the water, right? If you go by the wrong water, the water's going to be trouble. He's going to be trouble. And what happened, before they even attempt to drink, they would die of dehydration. They would die. He has to go by the calm water, the peaceful waters. That's what he leads you to. But it takes the gift of faith. And everybody don't have the gift of faith. The gift of faith is when you're able to step out and do great exploits for the Lord. When you don't mind being the one that looks bad, amen, because people don't understand what God is doing. And it's something that's in your DNA and your spirit that God has given you when he poured out the gifts of the Spirit. Everybody don't have this level of faith. And I look around. And sometimes we have to be careful because psychologically, Sister Norma, I think what happens sometimes, you got to look at cultures as well. Why do we think the way we think? Where did this come from? And again, it's ultimately from the enemy, but he used other portals to get it on us, to push us down, whether through our social status, through our economic status, through our color of our skin, because of our gender, the enemy will use these things to suppress you, to oppress you, to lean on you, to make you feel some kind of way about yourself. Do you not know that abuse and mishandling is a form of perversion? It's a form of perversion to pervert your mind. If you think about abuse, they take what you're used to before and they twist it and mess it up. So then psychologically it messes you up. And guess what? This stuff still is with you. This is why we got to fight for your mind. You got to fight for your mind. I talked about on Sunday, you better think. You better think the way that God has designed us to think. And think on the things in the book of Philippians. Think on the things that God tells us, these things that are pure, these things that are kind, all these things. Think on these things, amen. You won't be able to do the other things if you don't think on these things. For the enemy plays on your mind, even when your mind tries to drift away, and your mind will drift away out of faith. So I am healed. I am healed. I am healed. I am made whole. Amen. Amen. I know that happened to me. Yes, I was dropped. Yes, I was mishandling, you know, because that was the enemy's way of trying to keep you from your destination. And I'm going to tell you, that's what gets me, Sister Smith, is I get an attitude with the enemy. That's what gets me up in the morning. That's what gets me going. I know what you tried to do. I know what you tried to do last week. I know how you tripped me up. Amen. Somebody say amen. You know the enemy tripped you up. And you just getting yourself together. Amen. You fixing your clothes. You know, in the bathroom, got your makeup. You got your hair together. Amen. But a week ago, a month ago, last year, 5 years ago. Oh, my God. Don't let the enemy off the hook like that. You try to get back at an ex. Get back at the enemy. That same energy, that same effort, that pain, amen, that same pain that he tried to inflict on you, amen, you stop that, especially when it comes to your children. We got to stop this curse. We got to stop these generational curses, amen, in faith, even in pain. Listen, most time I operate in pain, and I ain't talking about physical pain. I'm talking about mental and emotional pain. I'm not talking about deep, but enough that keep pulling me back. I want to step out, pulling me back every day. It's a fight. It's a fight. It's a fight in faith. It's a fight in faith. I know you may look calm. You may look like you got it all together because you're the pastor. You're the leader. You're the choir director. You're the head usher. You're the boss in your job. Let me tell you something. Some people, especially in the secular world, they go home and they are messed up because we're wearing this. And I was talking to someone on Sunday and I was talking about, we're talking about children. And I said, even as adults, because it was a friend of mine I have not seen in 40 years. I've not seen him in 40 years. And we tried to catch up real quick about, you know, I knew he was there because he owns his restaurant. I wanted to see him because I haven't seen him in years. And he talked about, I did engineering, now I'm in his restaurant. I said, because what happens is, sometimes we jump into our doing and not our being. We do our doing, which is nothing wrong with it, but in your doing, whatever you do for a living, what am I being in that? And when you live out your being and what God has called you and purposed you to do, you'll find peace. You find it takes less energy. And we was doing some training this weekend, and the instructor, Rod, said, he said, I could do this all night. I could do this all day because this is my lane. This is what I do. And when you're doing that, even when you have difficult times, and part of it goes back to when I teach entrepreneurship, what is your why? Why do you want to do it? Not just to make money. You go get a job, you make money. But why are you doing it? Because your why will show up when the money don't show up. Your why will show up when the people don't show up. The why will show up when the customers don't come through the door. Because I know why I'm here. Amen. And when you know why you're here, amen, it gives you the drive. It's the fuel to do what you do. And you will notice how you will flow. You will flow. He said to me, he said, well, you could teach all day. And it is what I do. And even when I'm not trying to teach, especially when it comes to my wife, I got to mix to her. I was like, I can't be teaching. She didn't ask me. She just asked me to listen. I'm not teaching because you will find yourself always. And I don't do it for me because it's a gift. I don't do it for me because I see you. Because I see you. And when I see your passion, when I see sometimes you guys comment on it and I see it through the spirit, what God is saying, amen, it pulls out of me. It pulls from the anointing. Oh, God. When God, when you pull on the anointing, and that's what you guys do. You come here, you come looking for something from God. And this ain't me, this is God. He's pulling on the anointing that he has put on my life to pour out to you. That is why you could speak to several lives at one time. Now you're gonna see live to many souls at one time because it pulls on the anointing, the supernatural ability that God has given you in the spirit realm, amen, to speak, not just to articulate and give you information, but I'm talking about spiritual wisdom, knowledge, and insight on situations that I have not even had a conversation about. But what God will do, amen, what God will do when you send up your prayers to heaven, I tell you, it's like a satellite. You send it up there, that satellite, when I pray to God, amen, and when God speaks to my heart, it beams off of that. He deposited my spirit. Even now, as I'm flowing in the spirit, amen, the spirit is sending back that signal because you have a subscription. You have a subscription. Now, when you don't have a subscription, you turn on HBO, nothing's coming up. They will tell you to call your subscriber and sign up for this. But when I have subscribed, when I have signed up to be in the kingdom of God, I can receive the benefits of God. I can see, to receive a right now word. I can send a word that will heal my soul. What the doctors can't do, I will get that healing. I would get that healing. My mind would be regular. That's because we talk about faith, the gift of faith, and sometimes faith, healing, and miracles. They're three separate gifts, but they could be intertwined. Amen. Because my faith, amen. Because even when it comes to the gift of healing, when God gives that to someone, that is not them healing you, but it's God using them to heal you. And let me tell you something. It ain't something you turn on when you want to turn on. You don't turn off when you want to turn on. That's why we got to be careful. Be very careful when you go to these revivals and they on the healing. God does not operate that. Because again, what is about his grace, what I dispense to you, what I give to you, and it's his glory. And again, if you're in your being and not just your doing, yes, I know you teach. Yes, I know you do hair. Yes, I know you do what you do. But in what you do, when you allow God to be in that marketplace ministry with you, again, you don't have to speak in tongues. You don't have to shout. You ain't got to quote a scripture. But what did I tell you from the very beginning? When that love of God, that agape love overtakes the room, when it overflows, because now I can't contain it. I can't contain it. And that's why when you spend time with God, that's when you're in the presence of God. That's why in your meditation with God, it's not just to get stuff from God. It's not just obtain. He's not Santa Claus. He's not just distributing something. He's not a salvation army God. He's a God. He said, when you get in the face of God, amen, the face of God, not in the hand of God. When you do that, just like with Moses, amen, when he left from the mountaintop, what happened? He had to cover his face, amen, because the glory of God was on him. And when the glory of God is on your life, amen. Oh, come on. Some of y'all said, well, yeah, you know what, Pastor? I'm going through right now. I'm going through this and I'm going through this. You know, the glory of God. No, that's when the glory of God's on your life. When you stay in the face of God. That's what with Jacob, right? What did he do? When that angel appeared to him, he grabbed that angel and he wrestled with that angel. And he said, I will not let you go till you bless me. Because I know, God, you got something for me. I come to encourage someone today. I'm telling you right now, don't let go. You're almost there. Amen. Don't get out the boat. Don't get out the boat. I know you can see the shore. It's right there. You know, you're in a plane. You look down and say, yeah, I can almost see my house out of this plane. But you find a plane in a holding pattern. There's something that's ahead that either is endangering you or you're not ready for. There's some things you are not ready for. That's why some things in your life did not work when you thought they would work. God said, I have a plan for your life. I have a plan for your life. But what you try to do, you try to orchestrate. Some of you right now, God's hand is on your life. And I don't care where you go, what you try to do, how far you feel you get away from God. God said, okay, I'm going to bring you right back. Some of you on here right now because of that. You could not die in your wilderness experience. You could not die in your wilderness experience. You could not die in the situation because God is not finished with you. I come to encourage you in the word of God. Amen. God is not through with you yet. Yes, people might have thrown you away. People may have given up on you. Amen. They might have told you the least likely to succeed. But I come to tell you that the grace of God is on your life. And because of this grace, amen. And grace, let me tell you the beautiful thing about grace. Grace covers a mess. I don't need grace when I got it all together. I don't need grace when I can figure it all out. God, I need your grace because right now I'm about to give up. I'm on wit's end. God, I need your grace to get to this next part of my life. I don't know how I'm going to get over there. I don't know how I'm going to get through this. And I'm quite sure some of you right now say, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. The grace of God is going to take you through that. The grace of God is waiting for you right now. All you got to do is lift your hand as an act of surrender. God, I need you right now. I don't care how many degrees you have. I don't care how many titles you have in the church. I don't care how many colleges you own, how many Bibles you own. We all need grace. It's his unmerited faith, and we're living it in the dispensation of grace. Amen. We're not perfect beings, but we operate in grace. But let me tell you something. Don't abuse grace. There's something called lasciviousness. Lasciviousness, I believe, is found in the book of Jude. And it talks about how these men creeped into the church unaware. That's in Jude. Creeped into the church unaware, which means the word unaware or crept into the church means they came alongside. And what they did, they took the grace of God. They took the grace of God and turned to lasciviousness. And what happens, and again, grace is not a liberty to operate outside the realm of God. See, I'm supposed to be coming on here talking about healing. And I guess I am talking about healing. The grace of God is not a liberty to operate outside the realm or the parameters of God. Did I tell you grace is only as a metaphor? It's a cab. You got into the wrong cab. You got into the wrong Uber. You got in the wrong Lyft. Amen. Grace was sitting right there. You probably looked at grace and said, I don't like that. That car, that's a raggedy car. But somebody pull up with a Lamborghini, somebody pull up with a fine Porsche and things like that. I want to ride in that car. That's not the grace of God. We look at what other people are doing and we want what they want. We envy, we have jealousy, and what we end up doing is getting to the wrong car. When God said, I need you to get in grace. But you say, I'm getting grace, but why is grace so slow? Because grace is not to get you to your destination. There's other ways, your way, their way. It's not God's way. So when we start to operate outside of God's realm, that's why when they pass laws and things into this country, there's contradiction to God. I don't care what they say. Because you got to understand, this world, this is Satan's territory. This is his territory. We're just pilgrims passing through. Amen. And if we don't recognize that just because they say yes, don't mean we say yes. There got to be a moral compass within us that directs us back to the glory of God. If what you're doing don't glorify God, listen, agape love is unconditional love. People say God loves me. Yes, but he does not love those things about us that goes against his will. And not because God is tripping and not because God is egotistical. It's because he understands the end from the beginning. He understands that that sin, that way of life is the only road to destruction. And what the enemy does, he wraps it up. He's always an imitator. He's always one that comes along and tries to emulate. Even from the early church, when the Romans, who was an empire in charge at the time, saw that the Christian church was growing, and I'm about to say something, going to get on somebody, might tuck on some toe, they were growing, they infiltrated, and that is what the enemy does. He infiltrated that again, Sister Joe said. That's when the enemy comes alongside. He crept in us alongside. And what they did, they emulated the church. They could not stop the growth of the Christian church. So here come the Roman Catholic church, who emulated what Christianity is supposed to be. That's why you look in the Bible, there is no hope. Amen. These things that you see that's taking place, this became the mirror of what the enemy wanted to do to try to stop the work of God. enemy will emulate. He would take lust and make it look like love. And it's not the love that God said we should have. We should be able to love our brothers and sisters. We should have that philos love for one another as a brother and sister and not have eros when it should be philos. Come on, somebody. But when you understand that it's about the agape first, whether it's your spouse, whether your brother or sister, whether it's a peer, it's about that agape love because I love your soul. I love your soul, not your flesh, but I love your soul. Even as a husband and wife, you got to be able to pray for your spouse. You got to be able to pray for your loved ones, not because you like them, because I love them with the love of God. When we use that, when I say I love you with the love of God, that is not a tolerating love. Sister Josette, that got your attention. Amen. Amen. That is not what God has called us. So we have to be very, very careful. When he said he crept in alongside, it came. It's like somebody coming along the wall. Come along the wall. You don't notice them. They're gonna blend in. They're gonna blend in the tennis section. They're gonna get them a white uniform and some white gloves and put a hat on. Amen. They're gonna grab a collar and some Bibles. Amen. They're gonna get up and they're gonna have all these things up that look like God. Amen. But again, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Amen. There, Sister Bodie Josette, it's your birthday. Everybody wish Sister Josette a happy birthday. But it's about God. If it does not bring a return of glory to God, whatever you do, who is it bringing glory to? Again, let's go back to these gifts. These gifts are not for you. First and foremost, they're for the common good. The common good. If I'm not blessing you with a gift that God has given me, it's not for the common good. And if it's building up the body of Christ, it's bringing glory to God. Amen. The reason why the church can be under attack, the reason why we give space for critics to say what they say is because of what is reflected out of what we do. We cannot look like the world. We can't do like the world, but we got to do what God has called us to do. Amen. So we're going to talk about on Thursday about healing and miracles. And again, goes back. The healing is not from you. Is from God. And God chooses to do it when he desires to do it. Amen? And I'm going to say this. There was a gentleman out of New York that I met at a conference. And he talked about how God had given him the gift of healing. And he said, I've watched God heal people from time to time as I laid hands on them. He said, but my wife became sick. And I would pray and I would pray. And it's like God said, didn't answer his prayer. And he had to learn. And that could have been, I don't know. And I only met him that day. And he's sharing this with the group. And he's saying that God showed him, you started to take my glory. Because people were coming. They heard that you had this gift. That's where we have to be very, very careful. They didn't come to see you. They shouldn't see you. They should see the glory of God. Y'all know old school, and I understand this as well. When we get up, even our attire and how we present ourselves, don't draw all attention to you. But I should be drawing attention to God, that God will get the glory out of whatever I do. When you come to the church, and I heard a pastor say this one time, well, they're not coming for whole life, they come for you. I had to rebuke that fella. I said, man, please, you got the wrong spirit. You got the wrong spirit. I don't care how articulate you are, how gifted you are, how well you sing, how well you play, whatever you do. This is not about you. This is about the glory of God. It's about, because when the glory of God, that's what it's all about. Because then, when you're trying to take away the glory from God, you're doing what the enemy tried to do. That's what Satan wanted. He wanted God's glory. And he said, my glory, I will share with no one. So those of you that's here right now, God has worked for you. He's not finished with you. There's more. Take grace. Trust grace. Wherever God has you right now, whether it's in your career, relationships, whatever you're dealing with right now, allow God to take you through. Words are nice. Words are wonderful. They keep us going. They comfort us. Amen. But let us remember it's about the glory of God. Some of us right now need to repent because you've gotten your feelings. You feel some kind of way about something right now that you've been wrestling with. You've been going back and forth with. Trying to figure out, they don't get me. I should be doing. I just came to save your soul. You got one. He didn't call like he told Peter. Peter, he saw Jesus. He said, "If it be you, Lord, bid me to come. Amen. Whatever God has before you, whatever dream, whatever vision, whatever ministry, whatever it is, whatever decision you're about to make, Lord, if it be you, bid me to come. Don't throw the party and then invite them to the party. Let them be your event planner. Let them be your event planner. Your next move, let God do it for you. And you're like, God, you know, I've been waiting. He's like, well, no, I'm waiting on you because I already know what I got to do. So let us trust in the Lord with all our hearts. Let's not lean to our own understanding, but in all our ways, let us acknowledge him. And guess what he would do? He will definitely direct your path. Again, if you need prayer, you can call that number. We want to pray with you and pray for you. Continue to pray for our Mother Johnson. Amen. Especially on this week. And again, if you want to be a support, a blessing to the ministry. Amen. Again, Sister Latifah, we are praying for you. She lost a very good friend. She's gone through a lot this last past year. Please don't just say you're going to pray. Pray for her. We have our intercessory prayer team on here as well that is diligent in their prayer. We have prayers on Mondays and Fridays. If you want to be a part of that, I'm going to ask them to put that number in there that we can opt you in. Amen. We'll put it in the Morning Manna group that you could be a part of that prayer. It's less than 2 minutes. It comes on Monday and Friday. Again, we got Monday and Friday prayer, Tuesdays and Thursday, Morning Manna, and Wednesday we have Bible class. 6 days out of the week, we are in contact, giving you the word, making sure that God is speaking to your heart. We will not be stopped or derailed by a pandemic. Amen. But we're going to do what God has called us to do. Amen. Father, we thank you for these your people. And we believe you, God. But we know we come to give us life. You come to give us joy. You come to give us joy, God, more abundantly. How many believe that God has come to give you joy more abundantly? Amen. So I want you to be blessed today. Have a wonderful day. And let God continue to do what God does in your life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Some of y'all don't know it like that. Some of y'all don't know it like that.